And, you know, a big problem I had back then, which, you know, you see with a lot of new traders now, is not being willing to set stops and not finding your, you know, your place to get out. It's those small, you know, small losses are going to keep you in the game. And I didn't see that. And it, for me, it was real personal back then too, taking a loss, you know, it was like, you know, having to admit that I was wrong, and I took it personally, you know, and I didn't want to take the loss because, you know, then it was like, I was admitting that I was wrong. I didn't realize that was going to be what kept me in the game.
Welcome back, everybody, to Be the Trader. Today, I have a very special guest. It's Michelle Koenig, and Michelle is a swing trader who's been swing trading for quite some time, and now she gets to spend her leisure time fishing, hiking, horseback riding, and roping, which I didn't even know what roping was, and I'm from Texas, and when she sent me the picture, I was like, I've seen this for sure before, and it's really cool. So welcome, Michelle. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. My pleasure.
Of course. Of course. So let's get started, Michelle. For those who are like, who's Michelle? Let us know, like, what got you into trading to get into this whole world of, especially around swing trading.
Right. So, you know, my interest, I mean, I always had an interest in the stock market. And I think I've told this story before, but my real interest came, I went to Montana State University and got my degree in finance. And in one of my upper level finance classes, we had a group project, and, you know, we were all kind of sitting around together lamenting about, you know, I'm working at Hardee's, or I'm working at Burger King, or waiting tables somewhere, you know, kind of all of our part-time jobs. And we had an older student that was in that group, and we got to him. We're like, well, what do you do? You know, and he goes, well, I go down to my broker, you know, like every quarter, and I pick some stocks. And if I do really good, you know, I don't have to work that quarter. And if my picks suck, then I have to go to work at Hardee's with you guys. And that stuck with me forever. I mean, for like, you know, whatever, 10, 12 years after college, I was like, how does this guy, you know, like just pick a few stocks and he has enough money to live on? And so that always stuck in the back of my mind. And about the time when E-Trade and Ameritrade and all those guys were coming online, you know, where you could kind of do your own trading, started trading part-time, you know, just kind of messing around with it. And did that for about a year and a half, I think, and then made the jump to full-time trading after that. So, but definitely a different world than it is today when I started trading, because I started full-time in 2001. So different world back then than it is today.
Did you go straight to swing trading? Was that your straight draw? Like, you went, hey, I'm going to do this? Or was it like investing at first? Or was it day trading?
No, definitely kind of swing trading was my main focus. But I've always done some day trading, you know, probably as I developed as a trader, did, you know, added more day trading to it. Now that I'm semi-retired, I'm kind of trying to focus more just on the swings, because the majority of what I've made has always been from the swing trading. And, you know, kind of with the lifestyle that we live, you know, and liking to do, you know, the horses and hiking and doing some fishing, you know, it's nice to be able to not be glued to my screen, you know, 8, 10, 12 hours a day. So I like to have a little bit of flexibility there, and also just really to give the setups time to develop, you know. So I'm definitely a chart person. I love charts. I'm real visual, and the charts really tell the story for me. And so usually those charts with time, you know, will continue to work well if you give them the time and the room that they need to develop.
So you just started off really mainly, I guess, swing trading. What is it? It sounds like when you just told us a quick background, like it was pretty quick that you found your consistency. Is that the case?
No, not consistency. I mean, I found what I wanted to do, but I, you know, back when I started trading, you know, I didn't have a mentor. I literally was just flying by the seat of my pants. You know, I read books. And back then, you know, there weren't really chat rooms. I mean, there were message groups, you know, so I'd be part of those. But it took me several years to really get consistent, because I didn't start with a trade plan. I mean, I didn't know what a trade plan was. I just knew I wanted to be like that guy in my group, and I wanted to buy and sell a few stocks and make enough money to live on. So definitely took time and some expensive lessons along the way to figure out, you know, how I was going to trade, what my plan was going to be. Using stops, you know, getting better at entries, understanding how I'm going to manage the trades, where I'm going to set my risk, those sorts of things.
So you, did you go full time before you were consistent?
Yes, I did. So I've been, so I was married. So I had a, you know, I was fortunate to have a significant other who had a consistent, steady paycheck, you know, that gave me the cushion, I guess, between the ups and downs of becoming consistent, where, you know, I wasn't the sole breadwinner having to pay all the bills off of, you know, what I did. And actually, when I started full time, I did really well. Like the first 6-8 months, I tripled my account, and I thought, sweet, I knew this was going to be easy, right? You know, yeah, I mean, I was making a list of the house I was going to buy and all the stuff, you know, it was, I mean, and then literally, you know, whatever, a short time after that, you know, after almost tripling my account, you know, then I almost blew it up. I mean, it was from one extreme to another. So it was a very painful lesson, very sobering, you know, wake up call to, you know, getting your shit together, basically.
When you tripled the account, was it luck? Was it an actual strategy that you use now? Or like, give me an idea of what happened.
I think it was just pure luck. And I hit it during a time when the market started trending, you know, and so I was able to pick stuff, you know, kind of like the market we're in now, where the market's real forgiving, things are working well, lots is working well. I just hit some of that, you know, so made it feel easy, because you didn't really have to have a plan. You know, you were pretty lucky, and a lot of the stuff just continued to go up and move directionally when I bought it. So yeah, there was no plan when I started.
And what was it that almost blew up your account? Was it just like a couple of trades? Was it market, one big trade?
Market changed, and overconfidence. And then, you know, a big problem I had back then, which, you know, you see with a lot of new traders now, is not being willing to set stops and not finding your, you know, your place to get out. It's those small, you know, small losses are going to keep you in the game. And I didn't see that. And it, for me, it was real personal back then too, taking a loss, you know, it was like, you know, having to admit that I was wrong, and I took it personally, you know, and I didn't want to take the loss, because, you know, then it was like I was admitting that I was wrong. I didn't realize that was going to be what kept me in the game.
How'd you get over that?
Well, get over, you mean,
being wrong. Like,
I think
okay
just
with that.
Time. I look back and I think more than anything, it was just time in the seat of being wrong enough times that I realized that was just part of the game, you know, that you weren't going to win all the time, you know, and that you looked at the setups and looked at the risk reward, and just knowing that some setups are going to work and some aren't. So I just think time, you know, I just kind of got numb to the fact that, you know, it's not about being right or wrong. It's just part of the game, and you just take your losses and move forward. Try and learn from them.
And then 2001, so you went full time, you had quick 6 months of success and almost blew up your account. Yep. How long did it take you to be like, okay, I found what works for me, and now I can be consistent and I know I can do this? Like, how long did that take?
I'd say probably about three years. I was kind of a slow learner. You know, again, back then it was definitely different. We didn't have services. You didn't have, you know, chat rooms, you didn't have Twitter. We didn't have access really to all the information that traders have now. And literally I was just, you know, in my room at my house trading on my own, just kind of trying to figure it out. Like if I had a problem, I didn't, you know, have anybody to call up or get online and say, hey, what am I doing wrong here? So just, you know, kind of slow learner, and, you know, just learned from taking those losses. And I mean, I wanted to stay in the game. I knew this is what I wanted to do. I felt like, you know, I was lucky, because it was like I had found my calling, and I was going to trade, and I was going to make it work.
So if you're all alone trying to figure it out, how did you figure it out?
Yeah, I just read a lot of books, you know, and I guess from being on the message boards, and I do a lot of charting, you know, so I'd look at, you know, even now, I don't look at as many charts every day, but back then, you know, between 500 and 1,000 charts a day. And so the more that I started really looking at charts and annotating my charts and following price action, you know, that repetition of seeing the chart patterns. And because I read a lot of the books, you know, I knew I wanted to trade technically. So using technical analysis, looking at chart patterns, looking at support and resistance. And so just repetitive through kind of training my eye. I mean, I get asked a lot of time, like, what scanner do you use? You know, what is your, you know, give me your scan. I want to know where you find your stocks. I'm like, and I still just do it old school. I just have a long list of stocks that I store in stock charts, and I go through it every day, and I have them, you know, segregated out by sector and then by my main watch list. And I just look through those charts every day. And it just really over time trained my eye to really start seeing what I really liked and seeing those patterns repeat over and over again.
And so is it safe to say you kind of look at the same stocks? I know it's a whole lot, but like the same stocks over and over and over, so you kind of get more familiar over time too?
I track. So like, I kind of have my main watch list and it's like my garden, you know, like if you have a garden, you got to like really be planting new seeds all the time. You're throwing out the weeds, you know, you're tending stuff. And that's kind of the way my main watch list is, you know, I try and start watching those charts that make sense. Sometimes they take longer than others. You know, if something happens to the chart price wise, maybe news comes out that messes the chart up, you know, I might take it out of the list. And then I'm always adding new ideas in to start following. And I look at other things as well. You know, I'll look for insider buying. You know, maybe if something's had news that's significant that I want to start tracking it for. So there is a small part of fundamentals that I do, but, you know, probably 95% of what I'm doing is based on the chart.
What books? Because you keep referencing books. I'm just very curious. What books did you read back then?
The Technical Analysis of the Financial Markets by Murphy, you know, was like the main one. It was like, I don't even know. It's like 3 inches thick. And people always ask me, and I'm like, you know, if you're have insomnia, it's a great one to read in the middle of the night. It'll put you back to sleep. It's a lot about chart patterns. And a lot of what's in there now is not even necessarily relevant. Not the chart patterns, but stuff in the book is probably not even relevant to today's markets. But for me back then, that was kind of what gave me really my fundamental, you know, interest in technical analysis and trying to understand chart patterns.
And so give me an idea, like when you're looking at for a swing trade yourself, are you mainly just sticking to daily, weekly, monthly, or just daily, hourly, 30? Like, what do you focus on?
So I always start out with the daily chart. You know, I find a daily chart that I'm really interested in and I'll start tracking it. And then as it gets closer to, you know, looking like maybe it's going to move, then I'll start looking at it on the 60-minute time frame. And I use the 50-period exponential moving average, you know, all the time on my 60-minute charts. So I'll start looking at that, you know, and I'll start looking at support lines, trend lines, you know, making my plan for where my entry is going to be, you know, what level am I really interested in getting long at? You know, sometimes I'll anticipate and take, you know, a partial position, you know, maybe in anticipation of a break. You know, sometimes then I'll add, you know, maybe I didn't get all the size that I wanted, or maybe the chart's acting really well. And then I can look for another entry even after my initial entry on some sort of a retest or maybe another setup at a higher price level.
And so give me okay. So what about, you see some on the daily, right? And I'm just curious because I've been swing trading, just teaching myself swing trading. So now I'm very curious on how you've been doing it. And you're very it seems like you're more focused on technicals and
absolutely
your own technical analysis, your own support resistance, your own trend lines, which is what I'm all about. And so it's intriguing and I'm very excited to talk to you right now. So I want to know, what is it that catches your eye? Like, are you looking for like big picture setups as in like a big picture, maybe ascending triangle, maybe like a big picture, you know, potential major day, like major breakout potentially, or are you looking to buy near trend lines? Cause I do kind of both personally. So I'm just very curious on how you go about it.
So I try and be flexible in what I'm looking for, you know? And so I would say like the main patterns that I like, but I'm not exclusive to ascending triangles, like flags are great, symmetrical triangles, but I have a secret that I have to admit to you. And that's that I'm a dumpster diver. I love dumpster dive trades. I love cheap shit that's been beaten up to death forever and has a really long base in place and is coming out the right side, which we're having a lot of now. Mm. I love those setups because, you know, usually, you know, I mean, that stuff can base for 6 to 12 months. You know, most of the time, all the bad news is in it. A lot of the selling's done. You know, I can start getting some size and those sorts of things. And they start coming out the right side and they have a lot of room higher, you know, when you go back and look at the left side of those charts. So that's, you know, kind of my, like, if I had to pick, you know, one setup that I love that I get some of my best returns from, it's my dumpster dive trades.
Wow. That's very interesting. And I love it. It's I've seen those and I know what you're talking about. It's like all the sellers are kind of, it's not no more selling. It's just kind of hit a base.
Yeah.
Sounds like a very good risk reward setup.
Yeah, that's what I like too, is the risk reward there, you know, and you know what they say, some people's trash is other people's treasure. And that's kind of my, you know, thing there. But, you know, it depends on the market too. You know, sometimes if we're trending, it's easier to stick with your swings. If we get in a choppy sideways market, then I've got to shorten up my timeframes. You know, and I'm always trying to be flexible to see what's working. You know, right now, a lot of those dumpster dive trades have been doing really well. And so that's kind of my sweet spot, but I'm not afraid to, you know, trade an Apple or a Netflix or whatever, if it sets up as well. You know, maybe it comes down, retests the 200-day moving average, bounces off that, comes down, tests key support. You know, I'm always looking for something that I can make sense out of, something that I can make a good trade setup for myself in.
So first off, you know, you mentioned the moving averages. I'm just curious from your perspective, because I don't personally use them. So I'm very curious, because I'm sure people are like, want to ask this question themselves. And that is, just because you use that yourself, are you using that more as a guide, or like, will that make you get out of a trade that you're in?
So price is first. Price are always rules. And all my technical indicators that I use, and I don't use that many anymore, I've just got a handful. They're my guides. They're going to help support what I see in price action, but price rules. I mean, I don't care what the technicals are saying or the moving averages are saying. If the price isn't acting right, then I'm going to either have a tight stop on it, or I'm going to wait. You know, maybe I'd rather pay a little higher price than be trying to catch a falling knife if, you know, the 200-day moving average is cracking and not holding. So the technical indicators are always secondary to what price is doing for me.
Okay, that makes sense. And what would you say when it comes to swing trading, because you've done day trading too, and I know you say you'll dabble in that, and now that you're more semi-retired, by the way, what the hell does semi-retired mean as a trader? I'm just very curious what that means.
So I ran a swing trade service called Trade on the Fly multiple years, and I just retired from that in December. Just because Corey and I are gone more, I didn't want to have to be, I mean, I miss all my members. They all still follow me on Twitter. But I wanted to have the flexibility to, you know, if I want to be gone or we want to be gone for a period of time, you know, that I'm not either shortchanging folks or feeling guilty about not being there to do scans and answer questions and those sorts of things. So semi-retired from that, I'll be trading till they put me in the grave.
I believe that. It's such a job that you could do forever. Like,
yeah.
Unless, you know, knock on wood, like you lose your sight, you know, like if
I know, I thought about that. I'm like, I wonder if I need to get an insurance policy on my eyeballs.
Yeah, you probably should.
I know.
I'm nowhere like knock on wood, but like, I was thinking, what if like, this is all I do, and then I lose my sight. Like,
I know. I've thought of that too.
Someone who lives near me and pay them to sit here and be my eyes.
I know. I've told my husband Corey that. I'm like, I think that you need to, I mean, he knows and watches, but I'm like, you know, something happened to my eyes. So maybe you need to get in here and start looking at my charts with me.
Yeah.
You know, so if I can't, you can tell me what's going on.
That's so funny. I was thinking of the other day. I don't know what made that me think about that, but yeah. So it's just like, cause that's our biggest asset.
Yeah.
is what we see.
Yeah.
So I'm very curious on, what would you say is the biggest difference for you, besides the obvious of like time frame, but between like seeing a setup on day trading and seeing a setup on the swing trade?
You mean as far, so I like, day trading, I'm going to look,
are they different in terms of how you see a setup?
No, I'm going to be looking for the same types of things, just on a smaller time frame. I'm going to be looking on the smaller time frames when I'm day trading for, you know, chart patterns like ascending triangles, symmetrical triangles, maybe, you know, like on the 60-minute chart, is it crossing above the 50 period exponential moving average? I use on my day trading on the 60-minute charts, I use the slow stochastics a lot to help with looking at where price, you know, is pulling back and looking for it to reset from overbought to oversold. And then like, if price comes down to support or a key moving average, to help find that kind of overbought area on the smaller timeframes to help initiate, you know, my long areas, you know, or my long or short. I mean, I always say long just because that's kind of the market we're in right now. And that's how I trade directionally. But my other hidden secret is I'm really a shorter at heart. It's just not been conducive in this market environment. So.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Another dark side trader. I get it.
Yeah.
Did you swing short too?
Yeah. Yeah. I swing
really?
Short. Yeah. Oh yeah.
What broker did you swing short with?
With Ameritrade.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah. Really? I never swing short really ever. So I just was curious.
I mean,
okay.
I think I'm sure, about, you know, now sometimes, you know, there may not be availability depending on the broker you're with, but I try not to trade against the trend, you know, unless it's maybe just like a short-term pullback, you know, and a lot of times, like right now, I'll use the UVXY and go long, you know, the volatility. Yep. And use that, you know, kind of as my hedge if things are going to pull back short-term. But I haven't had any shorts on other than going long the UVXY for quite some time, just because of the nature of the market right now.
You know, you said something earlier too, that you said that if something's overbought or oversold, depending on the indicator that you're using. I don't use that indicator some, but I am still curious though, if you have any advice for people who do use that. I don't know what you call it. You call it the stochastics?
Yeah, the slow stochastics.
Can you give anybody who's listening any kind of advice on how to use that?
Sure. So what I will say, like, when I was a new trader, I didn't really understand. I mean, I had all these indicators on my charts, but I never really taken the time to understand how they work and what environments they work in. So if you're going to use technical indicators, it's super important that you understand how they work and in what environment they work in. So slow stochastics and oscillator, and it's going to work really well when something's chopping around or in a range. But if you get something that's going to move hard in a trend directionally, it will stay overbought or oversold for extended periods of time. So I know when something's trending hard, it's going to quit working. So I'll quit using that indicator on my smaller timeframes. But when something's chopping around back and forth, digesting, consolidating, those overbought and oversold readings are very helpful in looking for, you know, new longs or new shorts, depending on which way you're going. And then combining that with maybe, you know, a trend line or a support area, those sorts of things, you know, a retest of the breakout area. So that for myself is really probably the main, that's on my smaller timeframes, the slow stochastics, really the main, one of the main indicators that I use, you know, along with a couple of moving averages and then my own trend lines that I'll draw in there.
I love that you said that. First off, thanks for that answer. And then secondly, I like that you added in there confluence, like you need multiple things to happen, not just one indication, right? Which is so important because as a new trader, as you probably know too, because you used to teach traders and yourself was a new one, that we kind of get lost in that brand new indicator where we think we need to buy because this one thing said this, right? And I think it's important to look at the big picture, right? Which you do all the time because you're a swing trader. So it's like natural to you. But as a day trader, some people get lost only on the 1 minute. Whereas I know you still, even if you day trade, I'm sure you're looking at the big time frame just to see where is everyone else going.
Yeah. And it's always interesting too, like if people use the 1 minute chart, and when I've, you know, talked with other traders, especially guys that, you know, maybe focus solely on day trading, and they'll be watching it and I'll see their comments in a chat room or something about, oh my God, the price is imploding or whatever. And I'm looking at like a 15 minute chart and I have no idea what they're talking about because I can't see it. And then I'll be like, oh gosh, they must be looking at a 1 minute chart. And so I'll pull up a 1 minute chart. I can like, oh, I see why they think it's imploding. And I'll be like, well, try just looking out, you know, at a 5 or 15 minute chart. It might help you be less emotional in the trade because it's giving you, like you say, more context to the trade. Yep. So, you know, again, and going back to, you know, price rules, price is number one. Always technical indicators are just your guides to help you, help support kind of your thesis and what you're seeing in price. Because I see a lot of times, and even myself as a new trader, I would try and rely only on what the technical indicator was doing. And then price would be secondary. And that's opposite. Price is number one. And then everything else just is a support mechanism for what you're seeing in price.
What advice would you give someone when it comes to swing trading? Like if they've been day trading for their entire, like maybe they're not even consistent with day trading. They're just like, I'm trying to figure this out, but I'm working a job, you know, I'm at work, I'm trying to day trade on my phone, which is a big no-no. and then you're trying to execute, but they're like, it's overly stressful. Yeah. I want to try something else. Swing trading, let me give it a shot. What advice would you give them?
The biggest issue that I've always seen, you know, when folks come from the day trading realm is they all want to use the really small timeframes, you know, and I'm like, you know, start with your daily chart and then look at a 60 minute, maybe a 15 minute to help you kind of narrow down your entry area, and then just patience. And the other thing that they've got to understand is every stock is going to have a natural intraday range, right? And so with your swing trades, you're trying to avoid hitting that natural intraday range, because otherwise you're just going to continue to stop out. And that's another thing that coming from the day trading side of things, people have trouble with, because they usually set their stops way too tight. So you got to do one of two things. Either you got to size down, you know, and give it more room to avoid that natural volatility, and or you got to get really, really sharp with your entries, you know, and ideally that's what you do, is get your entry really good so the trade works right away. But you got to understand that you've got to give those swing trades some room, and then just being patient. You cannot stare at the chart every 5 minutes, set your stop and give it time to work. And you've got to get enough price history on the left side of the chart to help you see and understand where the right side of the chart may be going. And like right now with a lot of my dumpster dive trades, I'm having to back out to a 3-year time frame to see, you know, where has price been? Where could it be going? You know,
that's a great sign.
Yeah. You know, so, you know, but so patience and bigger time frame and stop micromanaging, which, you know, I mean, there's been times for me, I micromanage my swing trades too. And, you know, right now with the market that we've got, it's just, there's so much going. It's just so hard to, you know, I mean, if what you're in right this second isn't moving and everything else is, it's easy to feel frustrated with that. So it's just hard sometimes to stay real patient with what you've got when everything is going crazy.
So you said something about looking left. And for those who aren't aware what that really means, and she kind of gave an example. Look, she's looking at a 3-year time frame. She's looking at all the key areas of resistance, right. All the key areas, yeah, of old support that now is current resistance, to figure out where's the chart going to go so you can sell it, which is, I appreciate you saying that. And I also wanted to ask you something about what would you tell someone, like what time frames, like if they're brand new at it, what time frames should they like start with and maybe just focus on, maybe is it 2 or 3 time frames? I know you mentioned narrow your focus on 15, maybe to get a better entry, but I'm just curious, like someone brand new to it, what would you tell them?
I would start with the daily chart, you know, and look for the patterns, look for, you know, whatever metrics you're going to use to find that setup, and then 60 minute. If you could only pick 2 time frames, I mean, that would be what I would use, is daily and 60 minute for sure.
And then people are always wondering, they always ask me questions about, well, how long are you going to be in the trade? How would you answer that?
So it depends on a lot of things. There's some that I will take that I'm, you know, my time frame is going to be 1 or 2 weeks maybe. And then there's some that I'm, you know, ideally going to hold for, you know, weeks or months. But what I'm going to do is, you know, raise my stop as I get cushion in the trade. And a lot of times people say, well, what is your target? And I don't like to do targets. I mean, I'll always have points of reference above on my charts that I know are going to be resistance areas that the stock should stall at, it should pause, it should digest, you know, or maybe, you know, again, depending on my time frame, maybe I want to take it off and then reevaluate. But I usually let my stops, you know, take me out of the trades. I'll just keep moving my stops up as I get cushion. And how much cushion I'm going to keep giving the trade depends kind of on what I'm thinking, you know, time-wise for those trades. And also if I put something on, it makes some huge move really quick, a lot of times I'm going to book that, because you're never going to go broke taking profits. And then I'll reevaluate, you know, look for a pullback to add back in. So if something makes a really big move really quickly that I didn't expect to happen so fast, I'll usually book that.
I like that you said that you kind of, most of your trades you get stopped out of. And I like that you said that, because you're swing trading. So you're kind of like letting it play out until the trend kind of reverses if you're long, or there's like a clear sign that you're like, hey, like this is going to go back the other direction. So I appreciate you saying that, because a lot of people tend to get lost in the idea of, like in day trading, you kind of have like a quick target somewhere, you know,
Right. Within
the same day. Within swing trading, you might be in a, I'm sure you've been in swings for months, you know, like, and just setting it, because it's just continued to work.
Right, right. And my problem too for myself with targets is, if I'm so focused, you know, again, I'm going to have areas that I know are important areas from price history, but if I'm too focused on a set number and it doesn't get there, and I'm unwilling to understand that maybe the trend is changing or something's changed in the chart, and I'm not willing to book the profits because I'm so focused on some number, you know, I don't think that's good. So I try and, you know, so the other thing, when I was a new trader, I used to get so frustrated because I wanted to trade perfectly. I wanted the exact lowest price and I wanted to get out at the top. Well, that's just not realistic. Like, you know, I mean, do we get it once in a while? Yeah. And maybe there's traders out there that do it all the time. I've never been successful at that. So what I try and remind myself is, if I get the middle of most of these moves or a lot of moves, it's going to be really, really profitable. If I can just keep repeating that over and over, you know, and not trying to be perfect in my trades, just remembering the middle, you know, kind of getting the meat of the moves, those are going to be really profitable trades for me. So, and I found that I'm less frustrated, you know, by trying to think that I'm going to trade perfectly all the time. Sometimes, you know, I get nail stuff pretty good and that's nice, but I know that that's an unrealistic expectation, at least for myself, to think that, you know, I'm going to get an exact bottom and exact top every time, because it's just not. So
would you say what gets you in, and I think I know the answer to this, but would you say what gets you interested is 90% is chart, and then you may look at fundamentals? Like, in terms of, when I say fundamentals, I don't mean just news. I mean like profit, the balance sheet and so forth.
Yeah.
Warrants, so all that.
So the main things that I would look at in fundamentals is I'm interested in like, what is the float, you know, because stuff that's, you know, maybe lower float, if it starts to move, tends to, you know, a lot of times make better moves, you know, what's the short interest. I'm also interested in institutions, you know, how you know, is there institutional holdings in it? You know, have there been funds, you know, hedge funds been buying this recently? I'm always really interested in that. I'll track that a lot of times in the charts and make notes to myself if there's been fund buying and what levels that it's at, even if I'm not in, just because those are, you know, it's of interest to me when the charts start setting up. And I will read the news, you know, like, have they had good news? Is the earnings, you know, is there risk? You know, does it look like they need cash and maybe they're going to do some sort of a raise? So I try and have a feel for that sort of stuff, but I don't, you know, focus. And the insider buying is super interesting to me, especially significant insider buying. I don't care if they're buying 1,000 shares, but, you know, insiders sell for a lot of different reasons. And in my opinion, they only buy for one reason. So if there's a lot of insider buying, I like that. It's not, doesn't mean that I'm going to buy, but it means I'm very interested in the chart. And then when the chart starts to set up, that's just another sort of supporting factor for when price does what I need it to do.
Where'd you find that out, insider buying?
So I'll just look in FinViz, you know, I mean, there's a lot of different ways. I use FinViz a lot just because I can look at stuff in chart format easily and get all that information that I need right there on that page that I'm looking at. So
have you found that for swing trading, institutional buying is something that's very important to look at, whereas day trading, maybe not so much?
I don't know that for my swing trades that it's, you know, the most important thing. I guess it's just nice to see if there's been accumulation, you know, or if, you know, there's been buying over the recent quarters. You know, I mean, it's just another thing that I guess if I was going to say anything, that I'm going to put a positive check mark on that chart, you know, there's things are lining up, you know, so it's really nice when you can get the right news flow, the right float, you know, support from the funds, you know, insider buying.
It's like everything adds together. It's right. Confluence.
Exactly. You know, it just all supports your thesis. And then it's going to give me a lot more confidence in that trade when the chart lines up. But I'm not going to buy just because the fund's buying. I'm not going to buy just because insiders are buying. You know, I'm going to wait for the chart. But I make notes of all that sort of thing, because when I have that and then the chart lines up, it's, you know, like sort of the A-plus type of trade that would be, you know, high at the top of my radar.
Okay. Well, before we start to wrap this up, Michelle, I want to ask you just two quick things. I want to ask you, number one, if you could go back in time to 2001 and sit in front of yourself and give yourself some advice on how to get to where you are now faster, what would you tell yourself?
Get a plan. Trading is not a hobby. You got to treat it like a business. You know, if I was going to open a donut shop and I needed to go to the bank, I'm not going to be able to just walk into the bank and say, hey, I need 50 grand. You know, they're going to want a business plan. You know, they're going to want to know why and how you're going to spend your money and, you know, what your forecast is. I mean, trading is no different. And it's, you need to have a trade plan. You need to know, you know, what kind of setups you're going to like, what your timeframes, you know, why are you going to get into it? What's your entry? How are you going to manage that trade? What's your risk? And what are your options for exiting? How are you going to manage the exit on those trades? So get a plan.
Yeah,
get a plan. Yeah. And then, you know, and then also the emotions. I mean, as much as you have the plan, the emotional side of this, a lot of people don't talk about. And it's something that just takes, part of it just takes time in the seat, but also having that plan, you know, will help calm down the emotions of the trade if you really know why you're in there and what your plan for it is.
Appreciate that. And for anyone who wants to ask you more questions, Michelle, like they're probably like, man, I'm very interested in just learning more about swing trading. Even though you don't teach right now, I'm just curious, like if they want to reach out, where can they find you?
I'm on Twitter. It's Offshore Hunters with an S on Twitter. So they're welcome to send me some messages there and I'll certainly answer everything that I can for them out there on Twitter.
If you're not fishing, roping,
right?
Hiking,
yeah.
Yep.
There's a delay. It means I'm, you know, we're in Arizona for the winter. So we're snowbirds now that we're old. So we're roping right now, but as soon as the weather gets nicer and we head back to Montana, we'll be fishing and hiking. So
oh, that's awesome. That's yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here today and sharing with me your story.
My pleasure.
I know a lot of people are going to take a lot away from this, especially for the ones who are curious about swing trading. So thank you.
Absolutely. My pleasure. Thank you.